Welcome to today's webinar entitled From Thin Words to Thick Action, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. My name is Suzanne Healy, Director of Member Engagement and Business Development for APA. Just a couple of housekeeping items before we get started. The webinar recording will be posted to the APA website later this week. We encourage you to visit us at www.apa.org for upcoming events, as well as view archived webinars for continuing education credits, which can be located under the Continuous Learning tab. Mark your calendars for November 7th as we open up registration for our Fort Worth APA U program, where we will offer the Leadership Academy, the Institute for Facilities Management, as well as our next targeted titles and topics offering, Operational Guidelines for Educational Facilities. As a reminder, professional continuing education certificates are being offered for today's program. If you are an AIA member in need of your attendance reported to AIA, contact Billy Zydek, APA's Special Programs Manager, at billy@apa.org. That's billie@apa.org. Those who indicated they wanted a certificate during the registration process and meet the requirements will receive this certificate post the program. In the event you are joining us with audio only and are needing a certificate, we ask that you additionally contact Billy as the platform will not recognize audio only access. While we are currently in listen only mode, we will move to open mic later in the program, allowing for an open conversation and engagement, and we look forward to your participation at that point. At this time, it is my pleasure to turn the program over to Keith Woodward, APA's Thought Leaders Chair. Keith?
Thank you, Suzanne. Good afternoon or good morning, everybody, depending on where you are in your day. So we're going to talk a little bit today about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And as Suzanne referenced, this conversation is meant to be that, a conversation, not necessarily you looking at a screen at me, but yet having some participatory comments from everybody to make us all better. I think that's the way it works best. This presentation has been done. We just recently did this in Verona, New York with the Eastern Region, and we had a wonderful dialogue back and forth. So I'm hoping we can do a lot of that over the next hour or so. It will require people to be recognized and on the microphone and things of that nature. And I realize with over 150 people plus so far on the line, it may be a little bit challenging, but I do think it adds to the richness of the conversation. I do think it adds to everybody learning a little bit more than what one person can share. And that's really what I'm focused on, is trying to make sure that we can be as inclusive to everybody that's here, but also share, you know, some best practices along the way. So with that, I would say I could start off the presentation like this, which is Morse code, which I'm not sure anybody or too many people on the line would understand. And of course, that would make you feel a little bit left out because you might not be able to read or understand Morse code. Or I could start it like this, which some of you may understand. Some of the languages are here, but they're very diverse in the presentation and the words that you see on the screen. And of course, if we were still back in the ancient times, and I do have to thank discoveringegypt.com for helping me out on this, we would be using hieroglyphics. But the world changes, the world evolves, and in many cases, the world is a much better place. But all of that, the last two slides, are intended to welcome you to Thought Leaders. And of course, there are still other ways that we could communicate to you, but there are 59 slides in this deck, and I hope only to use 44 so we can have a conversation. And that's what that says in if you were had the hearing issues. If you had sight issues and this was a sign on your campus, you might read it like this. So I apologize, I didn't take into consideration everyone's learning styles because everybody learns differently, but those are just many of the different ways on all of our campuses that we should be thinking about how we include and be more inclusive in our community. So what are we going to talk about today? So let me just kind of give you a brief synopsis. So we're going to talk about what is a thought leader series. I don't pretend to think that everybody on the call would know what that is. We're going to talk about intentionality. We're going to talk a little bit about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And we'll talk about thought leaders' top questions to bring back to your campus. And then if we get to it, we'll talk about DEI in the built environment. So those will be the five kind of thoughts that we'll go through. So I'm going to start by talking about what and who is a thought leader. And as I said to the group in New York the other day, I said, well, this, when you look up thought leader on Google, these are the pictures that you get. Everybody just kind of looking off into the distance, thinking, apparently. So that's what we used here. So let me just talk about the Thought Leader Series, which is actually a free benefit to all members of APA. And to be clear, I work at Quinnipiac University. I don't necessarily work for APA, but I do enjoy the work that we do on thought leaders. So if we start in the upper right-hand corner, Jack Colby and Lander Medlin. Lander's obviously, you know, is the CEO. Jack has been retired for a couple of years out of North Carolina State. But they developed the Thought Leader Series to start conversations and discussions about the future of higher education, and not only in the facilities world, but as it goes through the entire enterprise. So from that perspective, that's how thought leaders kind of started. So our goal is to research topics and to find subject matters to be participatory in that process. And then what happens is we get together, there's about somewhere between 30 and 40 individuals that get together from across the university. Not only across the university from facilities perspective, but across, you know, the CFO, the presidents, the chief academic officer, athletics or student engagement, things of that nature, all those different positions kind of get together and have a conversation. So we have a conversation, if we transition to the left-hand side of the screen, into a two-day symposium. So we gather for 2 days. Generally speaking, the first day is everybody, and the second day we focus on facilities issues. And over many edits and drafts and so forth, we produce a monograph, and that monograph then is free to you as a member of APA. And you should and hopefully could take advantage of all of those things. Even if it's not your area of expertise, I do think it broadens your knowledge base on various topics. And I think that's probably a benefit to everybody. So kind of a brief kind of conversation about our past monographs. So I'm just going to list probably the last 6, 7 of them. I'm not going to talk about them too much, but here they are. So going back to 2014, all the way through 2017, where we tried to transform facilities to achieve student success, trying to talk about our buildings and our spaces so it is more helpful to our students and allows them to succeed at a higher rate. 2018, we talked about mitigating risk. We had a real good conversation about the entire enterprise and how risk comes into facilities and what we should be doing. Same is true in 2019, where we got into innovation in the age of disruption. We talked about thinking more entrepreneurially as facilities leaders across the United States, Canada, and elsewhere. Preparing the student for 2024, we got this in right before the pandemic actually started. We actually met in February, right before the pandemic started to impact the United States at a high level, in Canada and North America at a high level. So that's what we did there. And then we worked on connection, space, and place. And then this year, obviously, is diversity, equity, and inclusion. So how can you find it? So the monograph is, as I mentioned, somewhere between 30 and 40 pages, and you can read it at your leisure. But if you go to the APA website, so if you click on resources, you go to the Thought Leader Series, assuming you can then log in and you can take advantage of downloading the exercise, downloading the monograph. An exercise I tried this morning, and it took about 7 minutes for me to go through the process and do. So it's relatively simple to do. So I would encourage you to do that if you find this conversation interesting, or if we go back, if any of these that we just talked about have any sort of relevancy to you and to what you do on a daily basis, or you just want to learn, they're all there. This goes back, as I mentioned earlier, this all goes back to when Jack and Lander started this, and which I think is about 15 years ago. So I would encourage you to do that. So that's my little plug for the Thought Leader series. It's really the content. I'm a little bit of an owner for this because I'm passionate about it, but I would say it's APA's premier content vehicle that is provided to the members. So it's along obviously Facilities Manager Magazine and a whole bunch of other things, but it's pretty inclusive and pretty pretty in depth is probably a better way to say it. So with that, let's start talking a little bit about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so when the group got together in February, we decided collectively as a group that we were not going to try and define diversity, equity, and inclusion, but we were going to take the various definitions that are out there. And so we chose the Association of American Colleges and Universities and how they defined diversity. So this is their definition, and this is the definition we used as we had our conversation. So I wanted to bring that to the forefront of everybody so that as we talk through some of these different topics, these are the definitions that we used essentially to have that conversation. And here's a definition of equity. Really, equity is about fairness and being the same, and so that's we use that. And then inclusion, I highlighted the first two words in a different color because we're going to talk a little bit about that today, about intentionality, which I think I referenced in the table of contents when we started here, about trying to become more empathetic and understanding and complex. I should stop here and say, listen, I we had a good conversation, as I referenced when we were with Arapa, and I do understand, and we do, I think everybody understands, everybody comes at it with a different lens, right? So some people come to it, are much more versed in diversity, equity, and inclusion than others. And so some people have been living it all their lives, and some people, even in this conversation, were, Why are we even talking about this? This is something I do on a daily basis. Well, all that is true and valued and appreciated. There are others where this is perhaps an area of learning that can take place. So that's why this conversation is happening. It's not to say, this needs to be in the forefront because XYZ. It's a learning opportunity for everybody to kind of get into this topic. So with those three definitions, one of the things that the thought leaders thought was important was how diversity is valued across the entire institutions. So from the student enrollment to faculty to staff recruitment to our business partners and community groups, all of us that use the university, it was important too. But one of the participants in particular, as we were talking through this, said a comment that kind of resonated with us, which was every institution will say they value diversity, but they actually need to live it. And so it's that one little piece that I want to try and talk about a little bit today. And at some point, as Suzanne referenced earlier, we're going to be opening up the microphones to participants to have a conversation, because that's really what I'd really like to do, because I think everybody benefits from that. So a couple things from a couple data points, if you will, that are interesting. So this is from the National Center of Education Statistics. Only 40% of disabled students who started attending a four-year public or private institution in 2011 graduated with a bachelor's degree. The rate of students without disabilities was 56.7%. So that actually spurred on a conversation with a individual from the University of Minnesota and said, okay, if that's true, she examined the question of a sense of belonging. And I know all of us and facilities and capital planning, we look at how can we make our campuses have a sense of belonging to our variety of students. And I think I think Landers on the phone or on the call or whatever this is, can comment as well later on, but there certainly are millions of students who perhaps go to school for a short period of time and don't end up with their degree, which is fine. There may be very variety of reasons for that. But if one of them is that they have a lower sense of belonging, that is something that I think we, from a facilities perspective, can look at and try and figure out how can we do better in that particular world. So it's an opportunity now to kind of just step back and think about how welcoming is your campus, and does that relate to the students, and does that give them a sense of belonging? So sense of belonging, I think, is one of those things that's very hard to quantify. It's hard to touch, right? I think sometimes we try really, really purposefully to come up with what that sense of belonging is. But sometimes it's challenging, right, to do that. So one of the things when we confront inequity, it's a hard and sometimes painful conversation, and it's always risky, but we do so to be more inclusive, right? We do so to be more inclusive. And so that part of the conversation, I think, is important to have. And it's important to have, you know, going up the food chain and going down the food chain. And we had that, you know, when we had this long conversation in New York about this, and I keep referencing it because it was a really wonderful conversation we had. And I know it's challenging to do with now over 200 people here in the room. But it definitely brought a sense of perspective from everybody's perspective into the conversation. So how can we in facilities and capital planning be more intentional about DEI? So I'm going to give a couple examples, and I'm going to start actually at a board level. So the current president of Colorado College, it was actually the first woman of color to lead that university. And her point here, and then the second paragraph, is talks about how opportunities perhaps are now becoming more known. I'm not sure what the right phrase is here. And that people are now being forced to be more intentional and look beyond just the candidate that's right in front of you, either to go recruit individuals or to go be more purposeful about how you want your institution to look and to feel and to experience. And she's done a great job. And what she's also done is she's tried to do that across her trustee level. So when we talk about the entire institution, right, we talk about not just, you know, one segment of the university, we talk about multiple segments of the university. And so one of the things that can happen at the, what I'll call the senior leadership level, if you will, is engagement of trustees. And so when you look here just at this slide, it's, and I don't disagree, it's a little bit busy, but you know, the gender equality is pretty close. The trustee identity is pretty close. There are things that senior leadership does and can do to make board of trustees and senior management a little bit more level playing field with multiple groups represented in different ways. And I thought just the way that she's done that there stood out to me as something that was pretty relevant. So one of the questions we asked, and so this is kind of a unique question, is when is the last time you sat around at the staff meeting table and you talked about this issue? Now, for some of you, you will raise your hands, and some of you will say, yep, we're having those conversations. I can tell you that generally speaking, that's probably not something that's discussed at the facilities staff meeting table, right? And I can tell you that only from feedback from the individuals that were in the room back in February, but also the individuals that were last month in New York, and that it's not a conversation that is happening. And so much like, you know, you could take out diversity, equity, inclusion from that sentence and add the phrase sustainability, or add about budget, or add about something else, and those topics seem to get discussed, right? And so how can we bring that conversation, not only as a senior leader, right? If so, if you're an SFO on this phone call, you know, there's some responsibility there that, right, that this conversation start, if you haven't had the conversation. Again, many people on the call, some people are already talking about it. This may not apply to you, but for those that it does, you know, adding that to the conversation. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about my own personal situation here at Quinnipiac. But if I was going to ask for a raise of hands here, I think I would find that the vast majority perhaps have not had this conversation. So I would encourage you to have that conversation. So one of the things that the University of Virginia does is this is on their website. I understand not everybody on the phone call is as large as the University of Virginia, nor has the resources as the University of Virginia does, right? Certainly I don't, right? And so I know there are others that probably don't have that. But one of the things on their website is that last sentence that you see there, not the one in red, but the one in blue, that says, we speak English, Spanish, Swahili, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so what they are telling you is they are trying to be as inclusive as they can in their team at the University of Virginia that manages the facilities management team. They actually have their own diversity, equity, and inclusion staff person on staff, right? And listen, not everybody has 1,200 people in their department, right? It's a lot different. I've got 150, right? So it's a lot, you know, 1/10 the size or 1/8 the size of what they have. So that's probably not going to happen. But that doesn't mean that I can't try to be a little bit better at some of these issues than just because I just don't have a person, right? It's like that can't be your excuse on why you can't do that. So I'm gonna give you a couple examples of some of the things that Quinnipiac has done and with very intentional design in what we do. And then we're gonna get into kind of some questions that Thought Leaders talks about. And I am gonna try and open that mic up. I am going to try and be the moderator of 200 plus people, but we're going to try it because I think it will be helpful to everybody. So this is in our student center, right? And so these columns that are in the building, we used about 23 different types of wood in the building, and we've identified it. So again, very simple. We've from cedar to Douglas fir to tiger wood, but all from different parts of the planet, right? Which speaks to kind of our not only to our students, but to our community, that these things are important and intentional in what we're doing in terms of how we built the building. It takes some forefront in the planning and design of it, right? That's something that you want to add into the mix. And when you either renovate or design a building, but it's just one step, okay? And I'm sure there are thousands of others, and I'm sure there are better ones. Yeah, another two that we have here is up in the upper left-hand corner, we have the portraits of female judges in Connecticut. And so we highlight the women who are actually judges in our state. And that's done over at our law school. Very intentional, very, there for people to see. And when you enter the building on the right, the two photos that you see on the right is Frederick Douglass, who, as you can read, was an activist for human rights and internationally during the 1800s. And so that sculpture has been on our campus for, I think, probably close to 4 years now, and is at the entry point of when you enter the building. It's one of the very first, you can kind of see in that bottom right photo, is when you first walk in, that's what you see. It was very intentional that we, when we had an opportunity to acquire this piece of art, that it would be seen by many people as they enter the building. So those are just some small pieces. So for me, you know, it's one of the things, and I said this the other day, that, you know, the name you see on the screen, Liz Parker at Keene State, I have no idea who she is, right? I mean, I know who she is because I've seen her. But as many of us are parents on the call, and many of us go to either, you know, different sporting events or different events, and, you know, your kid's got to be there 45 minutes beforehand to do whatever they've got to do, and you've got 45 minutes to an hour before you have to do, you know, before you go and watch the actual game or the actual event or whatever, the play, whatever it is. So normally what I do, and I don't know, maybe some others do this, but I drive around, and I find my son was playing golf up in New Hampshire, and so I went over to Keene State, and I saw this woman doing grounds, and this is probably, I don't know, 10 years ago, I don't know when it was, 10 years ago or so. And so I stopped and I talked to her, and I assume she's still there because I've checked their website, but, and I said, oh, how'd you get into doing grounds? And she told me her story, and she's now an events lead at Keene State. And I struggle mightily to find a female groundskeeper. I pull over, I probably shouldn't admit this, but I pull over on the side of the road sometimes when I see somebody, a female groundskeeper, and say, you know, I'm just kind of stop them. Hey, have you ever considered, you know, applying for Quinnipiac? And as the group in New York told me, they said, that's, you're pretty much a weirdo in that particular case, which is probably true. But nonetheless, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to diversify our grounds division, which is all males, right? And so all that being said, how do I do that, right? How can I do that? I work with our human resources team. Just the other day, a female had applied for grounds, and the human resources person said, well, you know, we closed the applications. I said, well, can we open it up for this? This would be a great addition. Turns out the woman ended up backing out and didn't want to go any further. But that said, you know, it's moments like that, or finding a female plumber or electrician or carpenter, where you're constantly on the lookout to make your department a little bit more diverse, right? In some way, shape, or form. And so, like I said, Liz Parker has no idea her name is being up here in the thought leaders, but she is like something that I think about on a regular basis on how I can change our current crop, or add to our current crop of groundskeepers. So those are some of the things that I try and do, and it really comes down to how intentional you are. How intentional are you in the design of the building? How intentional are you in hiring, as I just referenced? How intentional are you when you're making small modifications? How intentional are you to make sure you feel like the students that are coming are belonging? One of the things I would encourage you to do is to have a conversation. Bring in a bunch of custodians and groundskeepers and employees. If you're a senior facilities officer, I mean, one of the more valuable things I find is talking to our staff, and things that they can relate to. It's been a couple of years, but one of the things we did during the World Cup is we picked a day or two where you could wear your team's jersey to kind of represent that you were, again, I'm making this up because I don't recall all of them, but you know, if Portugal was playing, you know, Sweden, and we had people from those countries that were very enthusiastic about the World Cup, they could, and don't wear your uniform that day. You can celebrate who you are and where you're from that day, which is a very simple task. We experience this in some of our picnics, where our people from outside of the United States will make a certain dish and they'll come in, and you know, at first, you know, you try it, and then next thing you know, it's like, hey, Susie, Mary, Tom, whatever, you're going to bring that again next year? That would be great, because that was really good. And I think you kind of learn a little bit in the process along the way. So it's really about how intentional you are, right? And so I think that's really important. So before we get to the questions, and I know we're about half an hour in, and can't imagine listening to me talk for half an hour. It's too riveting. So let's go back. So are there things on your campus? And Suzanne, if you could open up the mic, and I'm not exactly sure how this is going to work, so I may need a little bit of help here. But can you tell me, can you share with our community some things that you do that are intentional? And I don't know how, I might need a little bit of help from Suzanne on how we would do this. Suzanne, are you there?
I am. I am in the process now of letting them unmute. Second.
So if somebody's got a thought they want to share, that would be spectacular. If not, I can call on you.
Well, we might, Keith, need to go to hand raising. I'm not sure this is taking too long to do this, but.
I have a hand up.
There you go. Go ahead, whoever you are.
That's fantastic.
Steve Berry at the University of Vermont. And, you know, one of the things that I think everybody is struggling with, particularly within facilities right now, is hiring trades workers, period, right? And one of the things that we've been trying to promote as of late, because our custodial department probably hires the most diverse pool of candidates available to us in the area, right? And they're almost all entry-level jobs. So trying to establish a partnership with them for folks that, you know, for career advancement.
Yeah, I think.
I got remuted. Yep.
Oh, go ahead, Steve.
So that's kind of the tactic we've taken. I would say it's a tactic at this point. And we've had some success there. And because, you know, just like you're describing, we've had a real challenge with diversifying our pool. And now we even are having a challenge filling our pool. And here's something that we win as a university on two fronts, right? And depending on where you are, that may work better or not, but it's something to keep in mind. And it's certainly been something that I think we've had maybe half a dozen folks now that have made a shift that's been both a career improvement and helping to diversify a larger portion of our population.
Thank you, Steve. Anybody else?
Yeah, hold on one second, Keith. We've got another hand up.
Great.
And
this is Don Turner at Middle Tennessee State University. We are opening a dialogue. It's not something that we're doing yet, but it's a program that we're trying to develop to go and participate in career days at high schools when they have them, so that we can talk about the benefits of public service and specifically within a facilities departments within higher education while we're there. But it is a program that's in development now, which I think will benefit not only Middle Tennessee State University, but other area institutions.
So Don, is that something where you're going, I want to make sure I heard it right. So it sounds like it's a little bit more than like a career fair. It's something that the university is doing, or?
It's something that we are putting together a program to participate in high school career days when students are hearing about career options. Everybody is not a college candidate, you know, still in these days and times, only about 35% of high school graduates go on to college. Well, what do the rest of the people do? And some of those people might find their life's calling by going to a trade school or being part of an apprenticeship to develop trade skills.
Great.
Kishore, if you could come off mic and chime in.
Good afternoon, everybody, depending on where you are. This is Kishore Acharya. I'm from Asian origin, and this DEI looks pretty good buzzword to discuss. And what I have found is that people try to diversify an entry-level position. And when time comes for career advancement, I feel like there is a little discrimination. And I myself, when I was working at Eastern Kentucky University for more than 18 years, when opportunity came, I felt like I was discriminated because of my accent and because of my origin. Even though every university these days on paper, they claim diversity and all those buzzwords, but in reality, in our heart, we didn't have that. And qualification wise, I have more qualification than other counter peer, but simply I am not that you know, common group of people here. I am excluded even though DEI is there. It's a buzzword is there. So having conversation is one thing. Culture change is a different thing. We still feel like we have been discriminated, even though there are so many things are discussed and it have been buzzword, so to speak, but not really been implemented. So when it is implemented, that will be great.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, Suzanne, if there's somebody else, please, let's continue the conversation.
Okay. So Heather, if you can come off mic, please.
I think while Heather's getting there, I mean, I think that was kind of that was the question, right? Like that was the intentionality question in the very beginning of how we started today was, it's one thing to talk, it's another thing to act, right? And so I think what I heard was, and this is my interpretation only, was just that, you know, there could have been a better in this one case, and I'm sure there's a lot of different factors that make up a lot of different things, but individuals don't necessarily always feel like they got a fair opportunity. So
yep, like I had a lead green associate, and I had a PMP certification. I had two grad school, like computer science and civil engineering degree, and somebody with undergrad degree, a lot less qualified than me, got the opportunity. I did not, and I feel like I have been discriminated. And that's something I cannot prove in the court of law, but it's the mentality. That cannot be changed that easily. Right? Lately, I have a CEFP also. I have all kind of certification. I have all kind of experience, yet time and again, I feel like I've been discriminated, so.
Yeah.
Tara Adams, if you could come off mic for us.
Hi, Suzanne. Hi, Keith.
Hello.
At Georgia Tech, we have definitely, the institution has an initiative. We have a institute DEI, institution-wide DEI initiative. As a matter of fact, last week they held a symposium, or the week before last, a symposium that I think was very helpful, where we had guest speakers, and it just seems like that there's really some movement coming along with that as an institution. So I'm definitely excited about that. And then within the Department of Housing and Residence Life, I have a we have our first committee, DEI committee meetings, actually going to be tomorrow. And so I'm happy to be a part of that and excited to see where that's going to go. And for myself, you know, just in hiring and take initiative to, to hire diverse staff, it's important for me to make sure that my hiring committees are diverse. And so being very intentional about that and having some consistency with that is important to me.
Yep. Tara, if you can, if you're still there, I don't want to spend too much time. I think we have talked a little bit about hiring and things of that nature, Tara. I'm just wondering if, or you or anybody else that has opened up, and appreciate that. I think that's great that it's a difficult conversation. It's a difficult conversation to have on a Zoom call or meetings call, but because people aren't there and there are different feelings across the platform. But are there things on your campus that others can take away from that you feel, or any of you that have spoken up or anybody else that wants to raise their hand, that are areas that they can point to of success from a physical campus perspective?
Yeah. Can you hear us?
Yep.
Hi, this is Amanda Cambry in Avinash with Western Washington University. And one of the things that we rolled out as a recommendation from our committee was a shuttle service for staff who are on campus. It's hard to find parking, especially at our entry-level positions, to afford a parking pass. So we have a monthly barbecue that was hard for custodians and groundskeepers to make it back to the shop to attend. So we started rolling the shuttle around campus to make sure that all of our staff had the ability to attend, and then also included translation services for sign language and other languages, so that everybody at that event could A, be included, and B, understand and participate. So that was how we tried to make our staff feel those thoughts. We have a committee and we talk a lot, but how do we get that into action? So that was one little thing that was really meaningful for that group.
And what we did also in physical level, so as a physical plant, this is Avinash. We have taken that, we have DEI committees on campus, and we have one in facilities, but we took it on the leadership team to talk about DEI ongoing basis. That's one of our agenda items to talk about. And I just visited yesterday, we have a mixed gender restrooms now. Our newest building that we built has all mixed gender restrooms.
Yeah, we are offering some discounted MARTA passes. And so that's been a recent initiative, which is really great. And then we're also doing some safe space training through the LGBTQIA Resource Center. And so I've been fortunate to be a part of that training recently as well. And so just, knowledge is key, and just making sure that my staff, they're aware of these educational opportunities, and for my supervisors requiring their participation in these trainings. And so that's been important for me as well.
So generally speaking, I'm curious, and if others want to chime in, when you look at your campus, the physical nature of your campus, and that sense of belonging that we talked about in the beginning, are there things that you think you could do, or that you have done, perhaps some have done some things, that do make that it is intentional in terms of making it more welcoming to perhaps, let's just say, an international student, or someone from the LGBT community, or something along those lines? Are there any intentionality on that front in terms of the physical part of your campus?
So Erica Peltz, if you could come off mic for us. Erica's been waiting to get in for a bit, so we're gonna have her participate. That'd be great if she's ready.
Hey, this is Raj. Can you listen to me?
We can hear you.
Uh-huh. First of all, thank you very much. This is a wonderful webinar. I'm watching. I'm Siraj Khan. I'm from Oakland University in Rochester Hill, Michigan. And I heard a few comments here. All those comments are pretty good. One of the things is there, what you are keep talking, how internally you want to embrace this change. Talking is one thing, but internally, are you ready to embrace this DEI, inclusiveness, equity, and diversity? If you don't have the embracement internally, and you are saying the word intentional, but unless you are changing yourself internally, you are not doing the things what you're supposed to be doing. And it all started from the top down, really. I mean, somebody made the comment, you can have a diverse group of people at the custodial level. Yes, absolutely, yes. But when you look around the top stakeholder in any of the institution, it is very hard to find the mixed group of people. And even though it's rhetoric, even in my own institution, at the, all the way to the top level, board of trustee, president, and all those things, but it's more like a rhetoric, Larry. I'm not seeing the practical steps the university should be taking. There is no policy. There is no reprimand if you are not doing the things right. You can break the rules. Even on the hiring, one of the things I always amazed that in our hiring process, and that could be in probably majority of the institution or everywhere, when the candidate fill the application, why you have to fill the address there? Because in any big metro city in America, there are different pockets of the people living in different setup, different, you know, areas, things like that. Just by writing their address, you have the pre-notion in your head, the type of the environment somebody's grown up or lived there. And that mentality is already biased. Even you don't know the candidate, but the notion is already biased in your head.
And, yep, I think, sorry.
And the things like that, you know, like for example, when you're doing in any conference or the meeting, big meeting in the institution, there is no inclusiveness about certain dietary restriction for the food room. Some people have, like for myself, I have the restriction, I cannot eat anything what they have offer me. There is no, nothing like that. There should be looking at a diverse group of people have some restriction, so they have to have the food for everybody and things like that. This is a simple thing. I'm not making a fuss on that, but I'm talking about internally, until unless you start to look at every time when you are making a decision or making the things consciously, conscious effort, you will not make this change. Even at the top level, you sit down on the table, round table meeting, when somebody who is not speaking the language of this country, people all of a sudden become quiet. It looks so awkward, really. I mean, even though you are not saying anything, but you are saying the things, really.
Yeah, so I think, I know Erica's queued up next to talk, so I don't want to, thank you. I do appreciate what you said, and ironically, as you talk, there are some of those things that impact you also impact me. I think it's a shared responsibility on some of the comments you mentioned. Before we get to Erica, I will say, even here at Quinnipiac, we do a diversity check on all employees. I don't do it. Human Resources does it. I say, here are the whatever six candidates that I want to talk to. And before I can talk to any of them, a diversity check is to make sure that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing for my department. Through a different department. So it's very intentional on our part to try and make sure that we're doing as best we can in the process, right? I don't know exactly what Human Resources does and how they validate all of those things, but before I can even talk to anybody, which I think is a good step, right? It's a good step. It's making sure that, you know, that I'll use myself as an example, that I'm not just, you know, doing whatever I want to do, right? There's a process. And so I think those things are put in place to make sure that we are being intentional in some of our hiring processes. Erica, why don't we go to you next? I know you've been waiting.
Sure. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm with Kent State University, and we're a medium-sized organization, I would say. We've got about 400 people in our entire facilities crew. And so one of the things that you had mentioned was this idea of whether or not you had enough people to have a person for diversity within your facility staff. So in our case, I actually am both a facilities person, right? I came up through the ranks, and I also handle our diversities for the facilities department. And one of the things that we did, now this is from a more of a physical building kind of standpoint, we about 5 years ago started doing universal restrooms. And what we did was the first thing we did was just identify all the single user restrooms on campus. And it's a single stall, it locks from the outside, it's got a real door. You just change the sign. This is easy. This is the simple stuff. And not only is that useful for our transgender population, but it's also really useful for people who have disabilities, somebody who maybe needs a caretaker to go in with them. If somebody's on campus and they've got their small child with them that they want to accompany, you know, it's useful for a whole range of people. And like I say, just identifying those single user restrooms was really simple. But also, you know, a lot of people look at diversity and think, oh, we need to become culturally competent. We need to learn. I think that we need to change the language around that and start to look at it from the angle of being culturally humble, because I will never know everything there is to know about another group, whether it's international students, international faculty, groups that I'm just not a part of. And so to approach it with an open mind, to know that you don't know everything and be willing to listen to those people when they tell you their story.
Yeah, Eric, I think that's a great point. And so it's funny you say that, because that's just about what happened in this previous presentation that I gave was about that. There were certain people that in that conversation that were humbled, is a great word, right? Like I'm processing it now, so I'm mm-hmm. just trying to think about how that would all work. But it describes the situation that was happening in that conversation. So Erica, thank you for your contribution. Derek, I'm going to let you be the last one, and then we're going to go back to a couple more slides. I just want to talk about thought leaders about, so you all can go on with your day by 2 o'clock Eastern time. So Derek, you're up next.
Hi, this is Derek Morris from Georgia Tech as well. And answering specifically your question, what are some ideas on things that we can do? Being more intentional about the contractors. Most schools have a state-approved contract list. And what happens oftentimes is the same contractors get used over and over again. So being more intentional about women-owned businesses and minority-owned businesses, and trying to give them a little piece of the pie might be something. Baseball caps, especially for your entry-level positions. You know, the campus could invest, and it might cost a little bit, but can invest in specific either baseball caps or flags that can be sewn, or maybe attached to the shirts of folks from different places around the world. Which would show, you know, the diversity in the population. Electronic boards.
Boards.
The campuses. Electronic boards. And there's creeps that go along with it. And there could be messages in there about, you know, every month there's some type of diverse month or population that's highlighted, oftentimes several. So better use of the electronic boards around campus. Taste of campus activities, there's so many different groups that are represented throughout a campus or a environment. So there could be a taste of whatever that is, you know, maybe once a year or twice a year. Better use of the campus newsletter. Being more intentional about, and this is more of an HR thing, but ensuring that where there's underutilization or where there's placement goals that comes out of an affirmative action plan. Of course, it's not about trying to meet quotas. It's about ensuring where you have underutilization of the community that you serve, being more intentional about meeting those placement goals. Ensuring that there's braille plates at the entrances of buildings and at elevators and things of that nature, as well as audible messages. And the last thing that comes up to mind would be maybe ensuring that those buildings that currently don't, especially the older buildings that don't have elevators, doing an assessment of your environment to ensure that folks who are wheelchair bound can have access to those upper floors and for emergency egress. So those are just some things. And one of the things that Georgia Tech, that it does do is there are multiple organizations, student organizations around campus. And as you walk through the campus, you'll see these like flagpoles and their pictures on like a little flag with the name of the organization and the and what their role is in that organization. And it covers everything you can think of, all the different organizations that really, really get into not so much just the diversity and equity, if you will, but inclusion is oftentimes, we've got, there's diversity in every human being. So diversity is never really the issue. It's always about inclusion and equity. That's that's where we're falling short. So that's my input.
Thank you. Now, I value that. Thank you very much. I think what a great idea on the student involvement pieces. So one of the things, so I'm going to, I know we only have a couple, three, 4 minutes here, so I want to share a couple of quick things. So in the thought leaders, Suzanne, thank you very much for opening up the microphones. I appreciate that. And it was a great dialogue. And I think we could go on for hours if we wanted to, and we had the time to do that today. But so one of the things in thought leaders is there are always, what we always put in the thought leaders monograph is questions for campus discussion. And while we won't probably have enough time now to go over them, although I do think we touched on some of them, there are generally about 8 questions in the monograph that you can ask, that they're designed for you to have a conversation above and below you. And so whether you're the SFO or whether you're, you know, the whatever, maintenance supervisor and building, you know, 702 or whatever, you know, it's designed for to stimulate conversation. And that's what this, that's what the thought leaders is pretty much all about, is to stimulate conversation on your campuses. So here are some of the questions that you see on the screen now, and I'm just going to flip through them. We won't really have time to get into all of them, but they can be questions that you bring back to your institution. And as Suzanne said, I think this will be available on the Apple website for you to view later in case you don't can't do the screen grabs real quick or whatever the case may be. This will be available. So with that, I just wanted to say thank you. I think it's a wonderful conversation that we're having. I think it's in some cases more advanced than in other cases, but I do think Derek nailed it. It's about the a lot of it is about the inclusion piece component of this and trying to be fair and trying to be the same. So with that, thanks for coming out. I know there were over 200 of you. Most of you have stayed. We're at about 195 or so. So most of you have stayed. So I appreciate that. If you do have an opportunity to download this at the Apple website, I would encourage you to do that. I would encourage you to continue the conversation as well. So with that, have a great rest of your morning or afternoon, and I'm sure Apple will have other offerings in the future. Thank you.
Keith, thanks a lot. We appreciate your time as the chair today. We'd also be remiss if we did not thank our supporters of the Thought Leaders program. So we would like to thank Siemens and Johnson Controls for all of their endless support of this program and effort. As Keith had mentioned, we will be releasing the recording of the video along with the PowerPoint in probably roughly 24 hours. You will get a direct email with access to that. Again, if you are in need of any credits or any follow-up transcript information, Billy Zydek on our team at billie@appa.org will be able to assist you with that. And other than that, thank you all again for joining us, and we do hope you enjoy the rest of the day. Take care.
Thank you.
Great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.